I'm the Reverend Luke Waller, and I'd like to welcome you here to the Angus, Dundee and Perthshire Methodist Circuit in Scotland. This morning's worship is led by me, with prayers by Sue Marshall Jennings and readings by Joe Bullen.
We come, all of us, just as we are, to worship. Whether today we feel strong or weak, full or empty, God welcomes us all into God's in crowd. So let us come, just as we are, to worship.
This week we tune into the subtle or loud voices that undermine the well-being of community, and we listen for the equally subtle or insistent voice that patiently restores us as individuals to community, to being part of God's in-crowd. It's hard to be fully aware of what is influencing us, and we need diverse and honest voices to help us see us as we really are.
Serve the purpose of God in my generation. I want to serve the purpose of God while I am alive. I want to give my life for something that'll last forever. Oh, I delight to do your will. With silver and gold while I am alive, I want to give my life for something that'll last forever. Oh, I delight to do your will. The kingdom of God while I am alive. I want to give my life for something that'll last forever.
Let me know your will and I will follow you. What is on your
And loving Lord, you look us in the eye and remind us that we are already part of your family. Help us to let go of anything that gets in the way, that we may worship you with all our hearts. God of all, as one family, we worship you. We are mothers and fathers. We are sisters and brothers. And we worship you. We are sons and daughters, aunts and uncles, grannies, granddads, and we worship you. We are cousins and neighbours, friends and colleagues, and we worship you as your family, as your church, as your community. We worship you. Amen. Loving God, in Jesus and through the power of the Holy Spirit, you show us that there is always room at your table for one more. There is always enough time for everyone to be listened to. There is always enough respect for everyone to be valued. There is always enough truth for everyone to grow and learn. There is always a second chance for those who once turned away. For the in you crowd is always growing and always welcoming. Alleluia. Amen. And our confession. Lord Jesus, when our crowd is not your crowd, forgive us and help us to build community. When our words are harsh and our actions unkind, when we judge others rather than join with others, forgive us and help us to build community. When we are set in our ways and not open to change, forgive us and help us to build community to the glory of your name. God of truth and mercy, where we break down, you build up. Where we damage, you repair. Where we blaspheme, you bless. Where we isolate, you include. Where we go wrong, you put us right. Where we confess, you forgive. Where we begin again, you are with us. In Jesus' name, amen.
This is Auguste Rodin's sculpture of Eve. What do you think it conveys about Eve? I think that all of us, though probably well hidden, have felt ashamed about something we've done or that's happened to us. It may have made us have a low opinion of ourselves. This week's Old Testament story tells us that it's something that happens to all of us.
Our first reading is from Genesis chapter 3. Verses 8 to 15. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden, and at the time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman who you gave to be with me, she gave me the fruit, and I ate it." The Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel.
St. Ambrose spoke of the fortunate ruin of Adam in Eden, because his sin brought more good to humanity than if he had stayed perfectly innocent. Making mistakes, failing, starting again, can be a graced way to grow up into the person or family God created us to be. We try to live relying on our own way of doing things or philosophies or as a closed group. And when this fails, it can be the means of coming closer to God, flourishing and growing up. Jesus' family tried to stop him and fortunately failed. So now we're all invited to be part of his family, part of God's in crowd. Listen to this version of Psalm 130. Does it stir any childhood or other memories for you? Think about how easy it was for Eve to make the naive mistakes that she did, and perhaps you have made similar naive mistakes. Now you can look back, and perhaps you can see other perspectives on what happened, what you did. Perhaps it's now time to move on, to let go of any voice that whispers blame on you. Imagine that Jesus had met Eve feeling like this. How might he help her, or you, to be restored to God's in-crowd and to the community?
Our gospel reading is taken from Mark chapter 3, verses 20 to 35. And the crowd came together again, so that they could not even eat. When his family heard it, they went out to restrain him, for people were saying, "He has gone out of his mind." And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem said, "He has Beelzebul, and by the ruler of the demons he casts out demons." And he called to them and spoke to them in Beelzebub parables. How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but his end has come. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying up the strong man. Then indeed the house can be plundered. Truly I tell you, people will be forgiven for their sins and whatever blasphemes they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit can never be forgiven, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they had said, "He has an unclean spirit." Then his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him as he said, "Your mother and your brothers and sisters are outside, asking for you." And he replied, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" And looking at those who sat around him, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother."
When someone annoys me or makes me angry or hurt, I know that it's all too easy for me to distort what's happened. I rewrite history or find an unworthy motive until I come out as the blameless one in the tale. The Pharisees' slanderous claim against Jesus, "He has the devil in him," is just an extreme example of this process. Or perhaps it's not so extreme in our present polarised politics. Is there a person or group whose motives that we routinely suspect or make into a caricature? We would do well to remember that by acting like this, some have missed the very presence of God. For a house divided against itself cannot stand, and central to Jesus' ministry was the vocation to oppose Satan and heal people of evil spirits. The undermining, destabilizing effects of evil on individuals and communities comes in many guises. The subtle voice of the serpent to Adam and Eve, the derisory voices suggesting Jesus was crazy, the accusing voices of the scribes from Jerusalem, the ashamed voices of Jesus' family. Social media is known to compound negative mental health issues. What are the voices that undermine our own communities, and how do we confront them like Jesus?
Thank you.
Our joys and griefs are there, but one is near who fully knows. I'll trust his loving care. I know who holds a future, and he'll guide me with his hand. With God things don't just happen.
Families, don't you just love them? Recall your family of origin, parents, siblings. You were all different talents for impressing, being the favourite or the black sheep, testing boundaries. Families can be places of wonderful support or debilitating, or sometimes both and at different times. Families see the best and worst of us, shape us. Our churches are family too. Recall Jesus' family. His unique birth must have impacted Joseph and Mary's feelings about him and his siblings, if they knew about it. Was there a sense of the family living in Jesus' shadow? Imagine the story of 10-year-old Jesus debating brilliantly with the elders in the temple, being part of your family legend. Hard for any siblings. Then Jesus spent years helping his father in the family carpenter's business. Very respectable. And then this star of the family had lost it. Got influenced by the oddball John the Baptist. Been baptised and left home, saying he had a special calling from God. He had become a travelling vagabond, attracting criticism from religious authorities and collecting crowds of all sorts. What about the family business, the family's reputation? What did he think he was doing? Is anyone in your family like that? In today's gospel, Jesus' family tried to bring him back home, bring him to his senses. Because families don't really like us to behave radically differently, but try to make us conform to usual patterns. Jesus rebuffs his family. He isn't rejecting them, but making them realise that his family is so much bigger than just his birth family. It includes on equal terms anyone who wants to be part of it. This must have been hard for his own family to hear, who must have felt he should have primarily been loyal to them. Perhaps they felt threatened, less important, or didn't like the disruption. Certainly they didn't want to include outsiders who weren't apparently respectable. The Genesis reading describes the story of the serpent disrupting life as normal for Adam and Eve. The serpent tempts them to take more than is theirs to take. And knowing that they've crossed a boundary and feeling shame, they try to hide uncomfortable feelings by blaming others for their behaviour. The story describes a pattern of behaviour all of us participate in early life. Eventually, God invites us to grow out of it. We learn that we're precious in God's eyes, but so is everybody else. Absolutely everyone else. In God's kingdom, there's room for absolutely everyone, misfits and all. We all know we're loved. Need to move over to make space to include others fully into our community. Think about who you would like to be more fully part of your community and how you can move over to let them more fully in. This bank holiday Monday, I spent 12 hours fitting the tiles together to make my new mosaic topped coffee table. The tiles and glass pieces are of different sizes, shapes and colours. It took a long time and many frustrating moments before it began to stop looking like a crazy mess and start looking like something beautiful. And there were many times during the day when I wished I had just bought even-sized square tiles to make things easier on myself. It seems a bit clichéd, but I spent much of the time noticing just how much my table reminded me of being the minister of a church community, trying hard to make sure that all the pieces fit, that the gifts of each person are recognised, making sure that I notice how every piece, big or small, adds so much to the overall pictures, and hours thinking, wouldn't life be easier if we were all the same? Not as interesting, admittedly, but easier in many ways. Our churches claim to be the family of God. In a family, each person who joins through marriage or birth changes the family and the relationships of every member. As people come in, grow up, go through difficulties, grow old or leave, the ideal family will love and support them, changing and adapting at every change of circumstances to accommodate each member. My personal desire is for all our Christian communities to be authentic families, adapting and changing as new people join and bring with them their culture, experiences and expectations. I want people to be able to welcome the change in relationships that occur as individuals join and leave, and see these changes as an essential part of personal and group transformation. You see, if the church really does begin to look like family, then all its institutional practices will undergo change. And then, in the midst of the mess, beauty will appear, and God will shine for all to see.
Our prayers of intercession. God of truth, we pray for those who are slandered today, for those in the public eye whose lives are laid open to the world. We pray protect them mentally and physically and draw them close to you. We pray for journalists tempted to tamper with the truth, and for those whose lives are in danger for telling hard truth. Think particularly of those in Belarus. Protect them mentally and physically and draw them close to you. We pray for sportsmen and women facing the pressures of winning and losing. Protect them mentally and physically and draw them close to you. We pray for families where half-truths have destroyed trust and broken relationships. We pray for those where there is estrangement. We ask, protect them mentally and physically and draw them close to you. We pray for one another, especially where we have been hurt by the words of others and felt excluded. Protect them mentally and physically and draw them close to you. God of all people and all places, we pray for refugees seeking safety in the UK, that they may be welcomed and valued and drawn into the communities around them. We pray for those who fear being evicted in the next days and weeks, for those struggling to pay their mortgages, for those living in hostels and temporary accommodation. We pray for those who are worried that if restrictions aren't lifted as planned, they will lose their livelihoods their health, their future. We pray for children and young people worried about exams, about their futures, and for those excluded from and all who struggle with school. As we pray for them, Lord, help us to support them in Jesus' name. We entrust to you, loving God, our communities and communities around the world that are in turmoil. We pray for our families and the families of all those who have died suddenly and violently. We pray for our churches in this circuit and across the country, and in places where there is division and danger. God of our brokenness, unite us. Bring healing where there is hatred, trust where there is fear, and comfort where there is grief. These prayers we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Loving God, you sent your Son into the world to gather us all up into your kingdom. So be with us as we hear and respond to your call to do the same. And may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.